Hey folks, it's Janek Gwizdala. It's the Janek Gwizdala podcast. We're talking about a couple of things today related to pedals. We're talking about signal chain, a deep dive into the new pedal board I just built, and how I'm going to actually complete it. It's not done yet. There's a couple of minor details still to go into the build, and we're going to go over some of the options in this week's episode. And for those new to the channel, for those new to the podcast, this is the one video, if you're watching on YouTube every week, that is a little bit longer form, zero editing, straight off the top of the dome, and kind of pick a subject and away we go. So if you're here for the bite-sized chunks of information, this isn't that, but stick around because we're going to talk about some bite-sized pedals and potentially some information that I hope will be useful to everyone listening, to all the bass players around the world that come up with, I'm sure, the same issues that that I face here with the completion of this board. And this is going to be kind of a deeper dive from the Swiss Things, the Earthquake Devices Swiss Things video that I posted just a few days ago, kind of chronicled how I put the board together, where it's currently at, and what I was using the Swiss Things for. That video was really about that pedal more so than the overall look at the board. And I'm going to go into a few things because there's still the clean sound that isn't complete as far as I'm concerned. So if you ever had questions about signal chain, if you had questions about preamps, about compressors, about where any of that stuff goes, DIs, how to split the board in two like I have, how to use multi-effects and single pedals, this is the episode for you, my friends, my bass playing friends around the world. And yeah, let's get into it. Before we do, one quick announcement, because this always happens that I forget and I wait until the end of the episode, and I get so many messages about this. I want to get it out there as we start here. Two things. This week, it's sort of becoming a weekly announcement because these things sell out so freaking fast. This week, what is in stock here in the store in terms of physical books, the signed copies of my books that I do, we have some chordal harmonies. We actually have a bunch of 251s because I just did a video on 251s, wanted to be in stock for that. We have some Bass Player's Guide to Altered Chords and Scales left. We have a bunch of Bass Player's Warm-Up. And we have just in, literally today, all the good stuff and all the better stuff. As always, they're in pretty small batches. I didn't order hundreds of these. I get them by the tens, sometimes 20 of each book, just to keep track of inventory and see what's popular, see what's not. Also, there are a very few of these left, of these, let me see, can I open this probably, of The Union, my album from 2019. A few weeks ago, I found a box of these sitting in storage that had been just sitting there since 2019, and there are a few of these left. They're available on the website. I think there are about 10 left. I found a few extras. I put a bunch on sale before, but I found a few extras in yet another box. So there are 10 of these signed copies of The Union with Clarence Penn, Ruslan Sirota, and Philip Dizek, with John Patitucci producing, and my rather wonderful wife doing all the design and the packaging and the artwork and all that stuff. She's what makes it look beautiful like that. So those are available on the website. That's it. That's the commercial portion of the episode out of the way. All links are below in the description of the YouTube video. Let's get to some pedals. If you haven't seen the video, it's only about 10 or 11 minutes long. It's worth checking out. I'll link it in the description below or in the show notes. It's the previous, that's the latest kind of deep dive, or rather close, not so much deep dive, but close up look as to exactly what's on this board in front of me. I know the camera angle doesn't exactly lend itself to seeing all of this. I don't have any fancy multicam shit going on right now, but we're here to talk about signal chain and how I do it and why I do it and what comes first, what goes last, and where, hopefully by the end of this episode, where we're going to end up in terms of adding things to this board. Because there's still, I think, two things. I'm going to hazard a guess that it's two things that I need to add to this board, potentially a preamp and potentially a compressor. And I have a bunch sitting on the table here to talk about and give the pros and cons of, and hopefully maybe fill in some gaps in information you have on the subject. So let's see. Almost always up front, if we get to the pedals that sort of really affect the sound of the bass in a big way, and I'm going to leave the compressor and the preamp out of that for now, because I'm using the Swiss Things, because I'm using these two separate loops in the pedal board, I'm going to have that in my natural up the center clean bass sound, my sideman, my touring musician, my touring rig sound, basically. That's what that's going to be. And We'll get into that. I'm going to hide them under the board. They'll be always on pedal. So I consider that sort of the through, as opposed to the effects signal chain itself. And let's say you're not splitting the board up. Let's go there, because I know a lot of people are not going to be using this parallel loop situation. I've gone back and forth as to whether I want the compressor at the end and I want my whole sound and all of the effects and all of those things compressed. That, you know, if I'm going for a really specific thing, if I want supreme consistency in a synth based sound or something, then perhaps I'll put that compressor more towards the end, because I'm pushing something really consistent into it, like some kind of square wave, some kind of octave, to create sort of a classic synth bass sound. I'll generally put the compressor and that kind of stuff at the end. Maybe the preamp will still go up front in that case. If it's, you know, if I look back a year or two, I will have had a preamp right in the front, and maybe the compressor. I've also, well, before I commit to saying that's what I do, I've also flip-flopped on that as well. Compressor first, then preamp, preamp first, then compressor. I guess what I'm realizing as I tell you this is that it all really depends on what your use case is, on what you want it all to do. So probably you want to start there. You want to ask yourself the question, hey, what do I need out of the thing that I'm going to take to gigs and the thing that I'm going to take to the studio and, you know, potentially take on a plane or on a bus or on a train and go on the road and play live music with? What do I want out of that? Well, right now, in the beginning of 2024, here in February 2024, what I want is the ability to have an amazing, clean sound. I put clean in inverted, in air quotes, because that is going to involve a little bit of preamp and a little bit of compression potentially. So it's not exactly clean, but that unaffected, no chorus, no reverb, no bit crushing, no distortion, no octave, none of that. I want that really well-preserved natural sound of the instrument straight up the middle. And right now I don't have either of those things. I don't have a compressor and I don't have a preamp, except the preamp in the bass, of course. And it right away, I'm in the headphones here. Maybe I'll take one ear off because I have the amp on in the room. You know, and it, of course, it's going to depend what instrument you're playing. I'm playing this new RKM double P, like double reversed P, this thing that I got at the NAMM show that they were kind enough to gift me. Really beautiful instrument. I've been playing it a bunch the last couple of weeks. That's what I'm playing right now for those of you only listening. And I love the sound. I mean, I fell in love with the bass as soon as I picked it up and I connected with it. So that sound already is awesome. I can totally just walk into the studio, walk onto most gigs and play that and be totally fine. So maybe if I'm playing the Matheson, I want something a little different. It has a totally different setup in terms of pickups and electronics. And then maybe I want a little more action from a preamp. Maybe in certain situations, I want a little more action from a compressor if I'm palm muting. There are so many details that go into it. This, I guess I should have prefaced this whole thing by saying, you know what? There's no definitive way. There's no one way to do it. There's no, like, you have to put the octave in front of the fuzz pedal, for instance. The rules, that there just aren't any real rules, because it all depends on you and on what you want out of it. There are some, maybe some best practices and some things that will get best results for certain styles, shall we say. And, you know, I'm somewhat, I would say, known for using an OC2 style octave pedal and some sort of bit crusher or sample rate reducer. So that kind of sound, and I wish I could tear these off or just switch the order of them right now to show you that putting the bug crusher, the bit crusher, before the octave would not produce that sound. So in order to produce that sound, as with any sound, there are definitely some best practices, but there's no right or wrong way to do it, because at the end of the day, it's all about what you need and what you want. And it's about getting it to sound, it's about getting it to sound like what you hear. You know, I think we always have these, we sort of hear what we want ahead of time, or sometimes we hear what someone else did and we want to copy that. But when we're, at least when I'm really working on something new or something unique, I hear something and then I've got to try and figure out how I match with the instrument, with the pedals, with the setup, with the amp and all that stuff, the PA system if I'm playing live, how I match all of that to what I'm hearing. And it's quite rare that it's exact. It's quite rare that I hear something and then I can exactly find the way to produce it. But what it does is give me sort of a never-ending set of things to work on, which is always fun. So I get to nerd out and talk about things like this to all of you fine people of the bass community. So that's something I'm kind of a little bit known for, I would say. You know, as is, you know, John Davis and Tim LaFave, and we're all kind of the OC2 crew, you know, Juan Alarete and Jonathan Hischke, and there are a bunch of us in the OC2 camp. I have since switched to the MXR Vintage Bass Octave, simply because there were two reasons, really. Number one, MXR actually used one of my exact Japanese OC2s from the very, very beginning of when they used to make that pedal back in, I want to say 1982 was the first year of production, October, if I'm being a super nerd and remembering correctly. I don't know. Don't quote me on that. But I have a few of those from back then, and MXR literally borrowed one of mine to clone to put in the Vintage Bass Octave. So it's sort of my pedal. It's not even just an OC2, but it's actually my OC2 in there, which is kind of cool, actually. Just not even that they did it and it's out there and people are sort of playing one of my personal pedals, kind of. Not that at all. It's actually just cool that I can get that, recreate that sound pretty much exactly. And the footprint is tiny. I have a few of them, I think, so why don't I grab one? Why don't I grab one and show it to you? Like, that thing is tiny. If I hold that up next to a... Why don't I hold it up next to the one they cloned? There's the OC. That's the one. This is the one, the Octava with the R on the end and that specific color and the slightly raised power input, all the telltale signs, plus the serial number when you see inside. It's a super low serial number. Those are all the things you use to date the boss pedals. And look at the size. I mean, it's night and day. The footprint is what, less than half the size. So that alone is a massive, you know, a massive bonus. And it's sort of has that little mid button on it as well. So you can kind of get the other one, the bigger blue MXR sound out of this as well. You can kind of get it with a little more bite, and the tracking is a little bit more modern, a little bit more reliable than the old OC2. So I've since switched to that just because the old OC2s are a bit of a pain in the ass to be on the road with, and they're kind of glitchy. I still use this in the studio and I'll still use it to record, but that's more of a stay-at-home pedal. It's in unbelievably good condition. It's worth a small fortune now, and I have the original box. It's like really, become more of a collector's piece, especially once MXR bought this out. So I'm a big fan of that. You know, Tim LaFave uses the Octava, the three-leaf audio. We've all kind of changed a little bit. I know John Davis, who's using an old Pearl Octava for a while. Those are amazing pedals. I really love those. That's one big hole in my collection. I really wish I had the old Pearl Octave pedal. One day I'll get that. But I think they're going for a small fortune now. And they do a very similar thing to the OC2. I think that's why I never picked one up back in the day. But John Davis had one for a while. I know he uses the OC2. And we all... Although we cornered the market for a while in the brown box, we've sort of, I guess, moved on in a way. I keep bugging Yoshi at Boss, at Roland, to bring out a Waza OC2. None of this OC3 or OC5 nonsense, none of this modern stuff, but actually bring out a Waza Craft OC2. I think it would be amazing. That would get me to go back and start using the bigger footprint again, I think. Because kind of what they end up doing with those Boss pedals in this form factor when they Waza them seems to be really quite incredible and rather robust. So I'll keep bugging them. I don't think it's going to happen, but I will try my best to be an influence in that department. Anyway, so that's in my loop one. And there are some best practices for that. You know, I'm sorry, I'm going to jump all over the place here a little bit. I'm so distracted by all these pedals and a thousand things that are going on as I'm doing this live. But that's kind of what's always been up front in my pedal board. I've always had an octave pedal followed by some kind of fuzz or distortion or bit crusher, something like that. Right now, I don't actually have a fuzz, a real fuzz or a distortion or overdrive on the board. I have two, well, sample rate reducers, really, and bit crushers. One's the bug crusher, the bug brand that's coming into view very slightly there on the camera. The other's on the lower shelf is the Iron Ether Frantic. Actually, I have a second one of those I can show you. See, I was worried I didn't have duplicates of everything on the board, but quite a lot of these things I do. One second. Here we go. This is basically the one of the more unobtainium pedals in the world, simply because Iron Ether just doesn't produce a lot of these ever, actually. I was going to say anymore, but ever. They're like, it's just one person and they put up limited runs. I think they're doing pre-sales now, but it's really just a one person operation. It's not a mass produced thing. And I have a spare because that really is like, if I had to, you know, pick five pedals for the rest of my life, this would be one. So I've got that, which is in really good shape. It's basically in mint condition, hardly ever been played. I have a definitely more road worn and toured version on my board, but that's still doing great. So yeah, I don't have a traditional fuzz or distortion on the board right now. Having said that, I should give a little plug to Lucidhand right here, because I'm going to do a video on these two bad boys this week. Lucidhand, awesome little company, another one-person company in the UK. The Alma Comp compressor, really nice compressor. Been messing with this the last few days. And the Ground and Pound, which I think is based on a Proco Rat. Really nice distortion, overdrive kind of thing. So I've definitely, since I got this, the Ground and Pound, I've definitely thought about putting that on the board. I need to mess around and see how effective it can be with an octave pedal to make synth-based sounds, because that's generally what I'll use it for in the types of situations I find myself in, and especially for my own music, not normally just hacking away with a pick with a wide open distortion sound. So yeah, look out for videos this week. I think the next episode of the Pedal Studio will be on those two Lucidhand pedals, beautiful pedals. But yeah, what I have instead is the Bug Crusher, the Frederick Effects Bug Crusher, which gives me that kind of synthy reduced rate sound. Some sort of almost like the square wave or triangle wave or some kind of, you know, what I would be using a fuzz pedal to do anyway. That comes right after the octave. And because I have that sort of split into one side of the board, I have the octave pedal, I have the F-Emeron, which is an FM synth pedal, and a different flavor, a different take on the octave, way more synthy, and I can kind of open it up. I don't normally have that much of the FM in there. And I can have it go the opposite direction. Take all the clean out. Bring the clean back in a little bit. Really, really fun pedal. So I have two flavors of octave pedal, and so it goes MXR into the F-Emeron, and then after that I have the Franta bit and the Frederick Effects Bug Crusher, so I can do two kinds of fuzzing, if you like. The Franta bit can be a little more gated fuzz-ish. If I put that in here, I'd go more with like the BB bass preamp or something if I wanted it to be more manageable and consistent. The Franta bit is sort of a wild card. And then it has a toggle switch, which is degrade and obliterate. And when you go into obliterate mode, it even turns into more of a ring mod. We'll be right back. So it's a real kind of wild card pedal. Totally crazy. And you can do some, you know, quite out there stuff. So it's got range, let's just put it that way. And but it's weird. It's not something that's the most repeatable thing. It's not programmable. It's all knobs. There are no presets. So it is what it is. And that's kind of why this time I brought the Bug Crusher back, so that every time I step on it, I can have it set one way. It's just two knobs, the rate and the balance. And I can have this totally consistent and repeatable comping sound that really fills out the bottom of the band. So that's kind of how my signal chain works, from an octave and, well, distortion, for want of a better word. I know a lot of people are going to use fuzzes and distortions and overdrives way more than they're going to use bit crushers and sample rate reducers. That's just how I like to do it. And, you know, we're talking about years and years and years of doing this stuff now. And I started with, let's see, with the Softech, the bass balls by Electro Harmonix, the big black one with the one knob, and it's like a filter with a fuzz in it kind of thing. And of course with the Mugafuga MF-101, the low pass filter, really big bulky pedals that I was doing that kind of low end manipulation with those kind of sounds. And I've gone through everything, the Woolly Mammoth by Zivex, it's another one that's really hard to control, the BB Bass preamp, I've had one from Maleco Heavy Industries, that one's right here, I'll show you that. This little guy, it's just fuzz, Maleco fuzz, two knobs, one button, and inside there's a dip switch actually, which gives you some kind of octave options as well. Really versatile little pedal. I think it's another one of those cases where they don't make it anymore, which is really sad, because that's the same size chassis as the MXR, or is it even thinner? No, it's the same size as the MXR vintage bass octave. Like, look at these little guys. Those two together, unbelievably powerful little octave bass and synth setup, almost, in those two tiny pedals. You could run them off one spot, although this one says it has a 200 milliamp draw. That's pretty big, it's pretty heavy for one of those pedals, for a small pedal. But yeah, look at that, this tiny footprint. It's like, still, it's still smaller than one Boss OC2. You can hide these two guys behind a Boss OC2, and that does so many different things. So yeah, those are kind of some of the places I've been with that part of the board. And like I said, I have bounced back and forth between compression at the end, compression at the beginning, even having a preamp at all. Maybe before we get to the second half of the board, the deep dive, maybe we should talk about the preamp situation. Let's actually put the bass down for a second, because I pulled out a ton of pedals to show you. Let's start with some of the heavy hitters, the real big boys. Like, this one's even got its own Pelican case, and it is dun da da da. It's a Noble. It's one of the very first ones ever made. It's actually serial number 9. You can see there on the back, and Jack signed it. He actually recently, Jack Rohn, the founder and the boss of the company of Noble, he actually recently serviced this for me, which is awesome. So it's in like better shape than it's ever been in. The ground switch, I think, was I'd stepped on it on a gig or something, and haven't taken it out of the house other than to go to the studio since. So this is not so much a touring pedal. It still has the power supply and the tubes on the outside. You'll know the newer Noble designs have all of that inside and are way more touring and traveling friendly. Actually, the new design Noble would fit underneath the shelf of the pedal board. I should actually explain a little bit about that as well. So this whole thing is hinged. If I can hold this up to the camera, you can get an idea of, let's just unplug the volume pedal, you can get an idea of what's going on here. You can see the back of the pedal board there, all of this space underneath. It's a bit of a mess because I haven't tied down all the cables yet, because I haven't done the preamp and the compressor. But this whole thing is hinged, for anyone who doesn't know these Vertex Effects pedal boards. So that opens up, and basically I have my whole power situation underneath the riser, It's a Chox DC7 for anyone who's interested. Not a sponsor. Wish they were. I love their stuff. These switching power supplies are unbelievable. You have 9, 12, 15, and 18 volt options on every output. There are 7 outputs on here. And I think each output has up to 600 milliamps. It's switching voltage as well. So 110 to 240. It's an unbelievably fantastic power supply for touring, for everything. So anyway, long story long, there's all this other real estate under there. So for always on pedals, that's where the compressor and the preamp is going to go. There's also still space for an extension. I have the Chox 4, which will also go under there. It's a little extender, gives me 4 more power outlets. So when I put the preamp and the compressor underneath, that's what will power them, because I'm maxed out in the DC7 now. But with the DC7, I'm running an HX Stomp, the Swiss Things, the Bug Brand Bug Crusher. I've got a Ditto stereo looper here. I've got the Chase Bliss Dark World, the Pladisk Backlings, the Frantabit, the F Emeron, and the MXR Vintage Bass Octave. It's a lot of stuff to be running out of one power supply. It's completely silent and just fantastic. I've had nothing but good experiences. Sorry, I'm shaking the camera as I get the pedal board back on the table here. Had nothing but good experiences with Chox so far. Danish company, I believe. So let's just plug the volume pedal back into the Swiss Things. So yeah, so that's what's going to go. That's where, sorry. Whatever I choose is going to go. So the Noble, it's obviously a ridiculously great preamp. It's a really specific thing. It's a tube thing. It's beautiful sounding. It's huge. Not only is it huge sounding, but it's kind of a large footprint as well. And like I said, I have really one of the originals, the old one, number 9. So it's not really so geared up for touring, but it's something I cherish. It's something I love. It's something I use for recording. Sadly, it's not going to make the cut on this little touring board, for obvious reasons. I have another amazing thing here, the Caveman BP1. This is the compact version, BP1 compact. It's basically a Neve 1073 in a pedal. Again, it's a large form factor. It's almost as big as an HX Stomp. Just comparing the two here. And unfortunately, I would totally put this in my board, but unfortunately, it is just like 2 millimeters too high to get under the riser. Now, that may well be because my riser has been bent and it kind of sags in the middle, which is unfortunate, and it's a really stiff piece of metal. It is very well made, but I think the airline just did a little bit, we're a little bit stronger than the steel, and it got crushed in the luggage hold at some point. Not crushed to the point where anything got crazy broken, but there is a little bit of a bend in it, so that loses me a couple of millimeters of real estate. Otherwise, the BP1 compact would be a good contender. Actually, I think I tried before. I think it is just a millimeter or so too tall to go on the traveling board, but it's an unbelievable preamp. I have the BP1, the big boy, in my studio permanently. That's what I use for recording. And I have 2 of these for when I'm running a stereo rig. That's a really nice luxury. I can run a stereo rig, pair of DIs. There's also, that brings up a good point as well. It's like, do you want a DI on your pedal board? What's up with that? I generally haven't had one for the most part. On most of the touring rigs I've had, I've just taken a line out of the amp. Normally, I know exactly what I'm using. Of course, now I'm using the Ampeg, the Venture series. So I've got a V3 here in the studio. It's going to be similar to what I'm using on the road, either the V7 or the V12. And they have a spectacular DI on that. But it is a question, like, could I find something that works and sort of bypass the amp situation on stage and not have to take a line out of there, take it straight from the pedals? Definitely something I'm thinking about. Obviously, the Caveman does that. The Noble does that. I have a Miura K3 that does that. Again, real estate-wise, it's a little bit too high, although it's a beautiful preamp. I have this. I love the fact that this is passive. Here's another low serial number. This is actually a Janek Gwizdala prototype. I don't know if you can see that there. This is serial number 5. This is from Teletronics, the TDI. Made down in Melbourne, Australia. Really nice, clean, super clean, quiet DI. It's not a preamp though, but it is a beautiful DI, but it does need phantom power, which is something I'm not sure about. I'm not sure whether I want to deal with that. And it's an extra box, so I'd have to have a preamp and also run this DI as a separate box underneath. And then if I'm also using a compressor, that's three things that then go under the riser. So these are all, you know, super nerdy but really worthwhile things to consider asking yourself, like, what exactly do you need? I used to try and take so much stuff. I grabbed this to show you guys. Oh my God. I used to leave the house with so much gear. And this, oh Christ, even just the board is huge. So for context, let's just put a Boss there's one Boss pedal, okay? There's one OC2. Now, compare that to the rest of the board and you could get what? Well, let's figure it out, actually. I'd love to know how many OC2s I could fit on this board. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 8 wide and 3 deep, so 3/8, potentially 24 OC2s on one pedal board. This is a monster. It's not even the biggest one that Vertex makes. And as you can see, it's full of dual lock. I've used this a bunch before. I've laid out many pedal boards on this thing. I've taken it to so many gigs. It's just overkill. And I wish it wasn't. I wish I had a tech. I wish I had a roadie. I wish I had... ship my own plane, maybe. I don't know what it would take to really take that on the road, because I could make some, and have made some, beautiful sounds with it, with the amount of stuff I'm able to include on a board that size. But what it has taught me, what being on the road has taught me over so many years, is how to make the most of what I have, and to know that I don't need all that stuff to still make great music. And now, as I'm, you know, as I talked about in the previous video about the Swiss things, and as I'm thinking about now, as I rebuild this board, it's really important to have that clean sound, the most basic thing of all. Something that sort of, I guess, just came naturally to a certain extent, but I didn't really think about it in terms of pedals, in terms of the signal chain, in terms of buffered loops and just buffers in general, and how to get all the noise and the tone suck from all those other pedals. When you have all those pedals in series, not all pedals are created equal, and I'm not even going to pretend to understand the science behind it. I'm literally going on what I've heard Mason Marangella, the rig doctor, talk about, what I've spoken to about several great pedal builders, and they've tried to explain it to my very uneducated brain about buffers and how all, you know, literally how all pedals are not created equal, and true bypass isn't always true bypass, and series is a thing, and by the time the signal gets from one end to the other, it's kind of changed a little bit. So it's not unlike how I describe improvisation, and how I'm always talking about, hey, I don't want you to think about scales and about chords and about harmony and about anything, basically, when you play, because the more links you put in the chain, the bigger the distance between you having the musical idea and it coming out and being transmitted to the audiences. Really, you want the musical idea and the performance to just be two chains that are linked together, that never break and never have anything put in between them. And I'm getting that way with the pedal board, with the way I think about my clean sound and the way I think about really being a bass player. No matter what other, you know, sort of personal identifiers I have on the board, what other flavors and weirdness I want to take with me, and, you know, signature sounds perhaps that I'm kind of known for, I really am thinking about the integrity of the natural sound of the bass more than ever. And it's something I've been pushing myself to do. It's, you know, play different instruments and not be married to one thing all the time. And here I am playing a four string with, you know, 34 inch scale, really wide spacing, P style, maple neck. It couldn't get a lot further from the five string high C single cut Matteson that I play 98% of the time. And to be able to do that, I've had to, you know, be less precious about how I approach things. And I think I'm getting more precious about the bigger picture and less precious about the smaller details. So that's why I'm here. That's why I'm at That's why I am where I'm at right now in terms of the preamp and the compressor thing, the last pieces to go in this board. And that's why I'm not phased. You know, 20 years ago, I would never have played another bass besides whatever my main bass was at the time, the Federa probably. I just wouldn't have done it, especially not in public. And it would have taken me weeks to play an instrument and get used to it. And, you know, I had a P bass, of course, and a couple of things. But those are things I really, really worked at. And now I'm just like, I don't care. Pick up any bass and be able to do my own thing. So I want the board to sort of reflect that as well. So other options here. And I wish I had all the time in the world to do a 3-hour episode and have multiple cameras and just like plug all these things in and show you. You'll have to come back to the channel and hear the finished result, what I end up choosing to go in this board, maybe come out and catch a show. Going to be plenty of tour dates here in 2024. Something I've been using a lot for many years now, I guess since pre-pandemic for sure, is the Exotic EP booster. And that is basically when you select the vintage mode in the dip switch inside the pedal, you have to take the back plate off and mess around with the dip switch in there. But when you select the, I think it's called vintage, if I'm not mistaken, it basically gives you the preamp circuit of an old Echoplex. And then I turn the volume of the boost element all the way down so it's not boosting my signal when it's on. And I just leave it as an always on pedal as a really nice sort of vintage sounding preamp. And they're super affordable as well. The quality, like, I mean, it's a hefty pedal. It's way heavier than the vintage bass Octave, even though it's same chassis again, another one of these mini enclosures, which I love. It's way, way heavier than the Maleco Fuzz. Just a beautifully made pedal. Just, and aesthetically, so I like the brushed steel and the plate they put on with the name. Just really nice. Obviously, they're not paying me to say any of this. I went to Guitar Center and bought this one. I think I might even have bought it used, but either way, they're not crazy expensive, and I think they are massive bang for the buck. Massive fan of the EP booster by Exotic. I think I paid maybe $110 US for it, which for a preamp that sounds to me that good, that is like super value for money. So this, I sort of get the impression this might be the winner on this board. Just for space and quality alone, that could do it. Other options I have here and stuff I've loved forever. I've had, let me see if I can find, because I want to show you the evolution of the Exotic, the Trilogic. Actually, this is by EWS. I think they changed company names. Hang on. So the Trilogic. I've got the Trilogic and the Trilogic 3. Was there a 2? Hang on. Was there a 2? Yes, there was a 2. And I have it. What do you know? Okay. I love it when parts of the library are complete. So look at this big sucker right here. This is the Trilogic, the original one. This is by Exotic. Boom, big box, big boy. Dip switches, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 knobs. Just in and out. Yeah, simple, but kind of big. And I think 18 volt. Yeah, this one's 18 volts. Then we get to the Trilogic 2. Definitely an upgrade in terms of space. 5 knobs and the switches on the side, as not toggle switches, but just these kind of, I don't know what you call those, sliding switches on the side. Really nice. That says EWS. I believe they changed, or maybe they split up. That's the Trilogic. That's the 2. And then the 3. Same chassis, same, ooh, slightly larger, actually. A few millimeters larger, the enclosure. Different finish, but that's the Trilogic 3. I loved all of these. I've used all 3 of these preamps on my board at one point or another. And the Trilogic 3 is something I've used most recently. Some of these knobs were miniaturized, which I really dig. There are 2 toggle switches on the front, a high low, a middle, like a whole bunch of stuff going on here. So EQ and all kinds of stuff. And this is a 9 volt. Some of these, I believe, you can use a signal booster on. In fact, I think the EP booster, you can use a signal booster on to boost it up to 18 volts and give you a little more headroom. So again, it's not a huge form factor, and it has a few more features in terms of EQ I'm not sure I really need those. I'm not a massive EQ guy. I guess that's another topic. There's so many things to talk about, even with the basics, right? It's crazy once you get into the weeds. And again, it's like, you know, if I was doing a certain gig, I'd absolutely be an EQ guy because it would be a necessity. You know, if I was doing a metal gig, I'd really want control over the EQ. You know, there are things I talked to Henrik Linder about Dirty Loops, for instance, where he's EQing things, you know, different notes within a bar because everything's running to a grid and he's using the Axe FX and is able to like sequence the EQ. So one note in the bass line will pop out, like a slap note will pop out when everything else is fingerstyle, crazy stuff. So yeah, it's not that I don't like EQ. It's just that for the most part, the natural sound of my instrument is the natural sound of my instrument. I don't really need a bunch of EQ. So again, on the fence about whether it will be the Trilogic 3, or whether I'll stick with the EP booster. What other options here? Well, the SCR DI, I'm going to say it's not my favorite DI, although it has a couple of cool things that I really dug. But more importantly, Ampeg came out with a new one, SG something or the other, which has a bunch more features in it. And I played it at a recent hang, pre-NAMM show hang, and thought it sounded kind of fantastic. And it has the B15 emulator in it, which is one of the only things I've ever heard that I liked when it came to cab or amp emulation. I have it in the Venture, in the V3. I used it on a couple of recordings and it sounded amazing. So there is the option for that, and it has a DI and a bunch of stuff. So I think it's a similar footprint to the SCR DI that I have here. We shall see. I'm going to get that to do a big preamp shootout, actually. That's going to be fun. And then compression, who knows? I've used for so long, I've used the Miura, the M2. An always-on situation. Another low serial number, 54. I got some low serial number guys here. This, wow, never noticed that before. And I have a few of these, actually. I think I have two or three of these backups because I loved them so much. And yeah, the M2 by Miura, not a bad option at all for an always-on. Really subtle. I mean, like super subtle, to the point where it doesn't fit. And here's another massively important element to all of this. It's the feel. Some of these things are going to do stuff that are almost imperceivable in terms of how they change the sound, but they do, at least the way I have these things like compression and preamp set up, they do change the feel a little bit. And this compressor, the M2, was something that really sort of helped the warmth of my sound, but didn't change the feel in terms of like a really aggressive compressor. Now you can set it up and be aggressive and do the things that compressors are most known for, but this was something really different and really very musical. I felt, you know, I literally plugged it in, messed with the knobs a little bit and played some chordal stuff. I seem to remember at home, I was just, whoa, what is that? Some of these things sort of leapt out of my playing that I hadn't heard before. So it was subtle, warming kind of experience. So that may well go on there. Not to say that the Alma compressor here from Lusitand might also be a contender. Smallish form factor, sort of regular form factor, and really versatile as well. So I'll have to dig a little more into that. I haven't done so much of that with my own music, so that remains to be seen. I do have the BC1 from Caveman Audio, but that's huge. That's more of a studio unit, and I have it in my studio rack for recording, so that's definitely not a touring option. And yeah, the second half of the board, the makes a little more, on the weird side, I would say. It's where the modulation is. It's where the delays, the reverbs. It's where all my pitch shifting is. I had two presets in the HX Stomp, and I actually changed one of the chords to more of a minor vibe, and the other one is more hollow. Just it's kind of 159. So the concept, if you haven't seen the Swiss Things video, I highly recommend going to check that out. Again, it will be linked below in the description of this video. Just gives a bit of a deeper dive on why I'm using the Swiss Things, why I'm using the parallel loops. But as time goes by, and now a week has passed since I first set this up, it's really kind of coming to light how I'm going to be able to use this live, and basically how I'm getting so much more out of the pedals I have. Like, one of the things I said in the Swiss Things video was that it's kind of a bummer to, it's a big unit. It's not a small footprint, and I lost a couple of pedals from what this board was most recently to what it is now. I actually lost a couple of pedals, but it's helping me make way more use of what I have on the board, which is very cool. And it's also helping me sort of get way out there, you know, having loop two open, having these kind of sounds, and being able to add some modulation and mess with said modulation. It's a really nice versatile pedal. Shit, I could do another 40 minutes just on the Chase Bliss Dark World. But to be able to go out there and, you know, let's take the dark side out and just play. It takes a while to melt away, but just, I mean, that's already a kind of sound that's going to get you fired from most gigs, right? So you'd better know the band leader, or be the band leader if you're using it. Okay, so we start in a fairly sane space. But we can get way out there. Like, let's just crank things up. I'd probably normally progress into something a little more subtly, but let's crank some things up. Still running there in the background. I could even be here. And still use all of that decaying stuff as a percussive overlay to the bass line I'm playing. But, you know, and I don't even have to go to this sound, but I can go to the natural sound of the bass, still get back to my decaying situation. Amazing. So it really, it takes away the tap dancing, number one. And it's like, yeah, okay, I'm thinking in terms of setting up a preset in each side of the board. So the octaves and bit crushers, for instance, and then all the modulation, delay, reverb, and pitch shifting on the other side. And I'm thinking of like setting up, okay, I'm going to have this basic comping sound, perhaps, in an electronic music setting. Then I'm going to have some setting over here where I have a starting point potentially. out just now, a little reverb and some pitch shifting. But it's like that can develop. Like once I get rid of that, once I go from here back to the comping thing, because I haven't had to worry about switching all that crap off to get to the lower bass part, I can get into the bass part, move on in the song, and then start to think, okay, you know what, when I want a change, maybe I don't want the pitch shifting thing on anymore. So while I'm comping, I can just cruise over to the HX stomp, casually switch it off. Great, so now my preset has changed. And I can start building another preset in that loop while that loop is bypassed. Like that's what, you know, that's why I wish I could take the huge board. Excuse me. That's why I wish I could take the huge board on the road with me, because I could build so many options into each preset and just give myself that space and time while I'm comping to think, okay, what do I want next? Where do I want to go next? Of course, all of that comes out of the Swiss things, goes into the ditto looper at the very end of the chain. One thing I've thought about is having, you know, I'd love to have two, sometimes three loopers on the board. I've thought about tucking one away underneath the riser and, you know, using it when I really get into that looping world and creating soundscapes and, okay, maybe I'm going to have to lift the riser up and sample something underneath and then close it again. I don't know how often I would really do that. So again, I've got to be very realistic about what I have, what I need, and how to get there. And it's sort of live brainstorming sessions like this with you guys that really help that. And this is sort of my process anyway, whether I was recording the podcast or not, doing a lot of this stuff on a regular basis. One thing I didn't show in the Swiss Things video, one thing I didn't even have set up yet, was a volume pedal. I'm just using an Ernie Ball VP Junior right now off to the side. The Swiss Things does have a volume / expression input, although I'm not using it for that. It also has a tuner out. I'm not using that either because I have a tuner in the HX stomp. And I was really hoping this add-on would be here by now, but I don't think it's arriving until tomorrow. There's this little extra foot switch 4 and 5 add-on that I got, and I forget the name of the company. I'll shout them out when it comes. I'll probably end up making a video on it, but it gives me access to foot switches 4 and 5 on the regular stomp that only has 3 built-in switches. So I'm about to have you know, a lot more access to a lot more things in the stomp. So that was also a reason why I didn't really mind losing a couple of things off the board, because I'm going to be able to get to a lot more stuff in the stomp than I ever have before. In that side, you know, in that preset, in loop 2, where I have it. They do recommend in the Swiss Things that you set up your octaves and distortions in loop 1 and then everything else in loop 2. I think because they run into each other in series when you have them both in. So it does make sense. It kind of keeps that integral basic frame of, you know, basic framework of basic concept of laying out the pedal board, octaves, fuzzes, distortions. Then you get into some sort of modulation, maybe choruses, vibrato, tremolo, pitch shifting potentially. And then towards the end, you're going to have your delays, your reverbs, and finally a looper. And depending on how you set it up, potentially a compressor towards the end. Maybe you do that towards the beginning. That all depends what you're looking for. And then buffers, like this is buffered. I don't 100% understand buffers, but from what I do understand, it maintains the integrity of your signal, whereas some pedals suck that away. And it's absolutely something I noticed a difference in. Definitely in the sound, but also in the fingers. Like I noticed the response in the fingers being different when I was playing through the Swiss Things. And I'm sure it's not unique in that sense. I know you can just put buffers in your board. I know Mason Marangella, the Rig Doctor, Vertex Effects, talks about that a lot, especially for guitar players. And there are tons of videos that I've watched on his channel about that. And something I never really considered that much for the bass, but here I am doing it, and it's actually making a difference right now. So let's see. Is this the final setup? No, of course not. It's going to change 50 more times in the next probably 10 years. I don't know. Maybe the next 10 months. Who really knows? Really depends what I'm doing. But it's nice to know my touring is kind of laid out for the next few months, at least through June or July. I'm going to be in the US a bunch, East Coast, Midwest. Playing in LA at the Baked Potato with Steve Smith, Vital Information. That is May 3, 4, 5, I believe it is, something like that. Then we go to China, to Taiwan, like a bunch of stuff is already laid out. So I sort of know what I need. You know, I'm planning on a new record, a new big project. I really would like that to be in Japan. Who knows yet? 2024 big project that still isn't set as of yet, but that probably won't be until October or November. And then when it's my own project, I feel like I can take a board like this, the sort of the nucleus, the brain center of it all, and then just have little add-ons. And to that end, I'll probably take some sort of extra external loop situation, so I can add pedals to and from the board as and when I need them, for little flourishes here and there, little different flavors when I hear them on a song, when it makes sense for the production. So yeah, it's versatile, I will say that. It really is quite versatile for how small it is and how kind of few pedals. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 pedals on the board that do anything to the sound. We have utility pedals like the looper and the Swiss things, so that makes 9 total. Then I'll have a preamp and a compressor most likely underneath, so that's 11 pedals on a tiny board with all the power. Goes in a small Pelican 1510. It's definitely, yeah, it's as versatile and as small as there's the best balance between those two things I've been able to find so far, and I'll continue to update you all on it as it inevitably updates and changes and morphs and goes in all kinds of different places. Before I get out of here, Chordal Harmony, Jazz Vocabulary 251, Bass Player's Guide to Altered Chords and Scales, Bass Player's Warm Up, all the good stuff and all the better stuff are in stock right now. My most popular book, Pentatonics, as I'm sure any of you are aware, if you tried to go buy a signed copy at my website, it's been sold out for a minute. They sell out so quick. I am upping the order. Every time I order copies, I'm upping it slightly each time. I don't want to get stuck here with 500 books and eventually they just stop selling. So I'm upping it proportionally each time, but they do sell out really quick. This week they're coming back. In a few days they will be back, but they inevitably will sell out again. So be quick if you want one of the Pentatonic books. Otherwise, all of the others are in stock right now. Albeit in limited supply. And if you want a lesson on 251s and one kind of line, one linear idea that sort of unlocked my playing in a big way, not just my soloing but my bass playing as well, that was the last video I posted on the channel, so go check that out. It's also linked in the description below. And the last few CDs from the Union from 2019, signed copies of the CD are shipping worldwide as well, so go grab one of those. If you're a fan of real music and actually still have a CD player, if you're one of the few of us that still that can listen to music on in its physical form, and that's it. Holy crap, that was a lot of talking, there was a lot of pedals. This was twice the length I anticipated it being, but it's always fun to talk about this stuff out loud. Give me comments, give me feedback, let me know what you think, what you need, and if you have questions about signal chain and signal flow and signal path and what pedals should go where, let me know. I'm always happy to answer questions. I try and get to all the comments that get left. And until next time, that's it. Later.